I mean, I would say this took me a long time to do something like this. I know it's only been like 5 to 6 months, but I really want to publicly talk about my emotional feelings towards this situation because I feel like I'm the only one that hasn't been able to say anything publicly. I want to say, though, I know a lot of people are probably going to misinterpret this. This video isn't a smear campaign and it's definitely not a hit piece, but I do want to share my feelings because my feelings are valid in this situation. And I feel like I've lost so much in the last 6 months that I don't know how to explain to you what I've gone through. The last 3 years of my life have felt like I've had to look over my shoulder worrying about something if it was too good to be true. And nowadays I'm learning that that's just a fact. Some things are too good to be true. I have to worry about whether or not, when good things happen to me, how quickly is it going to be taken away? I've come to be a self-aware person when it comes to certain situations. When I was, when I was young, I was a kid, I pretty much grew up without a father in my life. My dad, I could probably talk to you guys about my dad, the positives, as much as I can. There are very few positive memories of my father. My father was in and out of prison. He used to do so many bad things. As a kid, he was just kind of a fable to my life. So every time my mom tried to get close with a man and build a relationship and me build a relationship to where I felt like I had a father figure, it always came back as the same result. I just got too close and everything fell apart. I'm not allowed to have a father figure. My whole life, I walked through doing the things I should have done under the surveillance of my mother. Learning to shave, all those things that you should do with your father. My mom, she was a... I never really grew to appreciate how much she actually put, or had been put through as a single mother with two kids. After 3 years, I still can't fully identify with her. But I'm very proud to know that that was my mom. And I took it for granted a lot of times. But I promised myself in that moment, after my mom died, that I would try to do my best to make her proud. I wanted to live my dreams. I wanted to do the things that I really wanted to do. But before she passed away, she had one last relationship. And I had grown to really start to really love and care about this person. And I was a very unexpressive person. I really didn't know how to express love or affection or caring towards people because it was always something that I had a hard time with. I didn't know how to emotionally show how much I cared about somebody. And I went on for 13 years talking to this specific person to the point where we actually built a close friendship to even the point where my mom asked me before she passed away to talk to him more because he feels like you're the son that he never had. That he really wants to be close to you and help you. I kept telling myself that I would never again allow a man to claim that he wanted to be there for me. This is me talking about my relationship and my job and my career with the DeFilippo triplets and their downfall. I kind of feel like I'm the one that isn't vocal. I was caught up in the middle of all of it, and I don't think a lot of people understand what an emotional toll it had on me. I had to get my composure for a second because I wasn't expecting to cry that early in the video, but yeah, 13 years, a friendship that I really respected that was centered around just phone calls, but Tim was always the one that I was able to talk to and turn to. I feel like Tim was really a kindred spirit to me because I feel like he understood me and was under, he really was a person that tried to put as much effort as he could to be there for me, especially after my mom died. I feel like him and my mother had a relationship that I don't think I can describe, you know? And that's why we got so close, is because my mother really advocated for that. It wasn't about the Power Rangers. It wasn't the fact that he was a Power Ranger actor. It was because Tim was genuinely a good man. And I feel like Tim, as much as I've talked to him about what happened in the Power Ranger fandom or what happened when it came to me, because I was bullied very harshly in the Power Ranger fandom, and Tim literally took it upon himself to be by my side the whole time. At this time, Tim really wanted to, I believe in 2000, it was like 2013, 2012, 2013, he wanted to learn about autism because my mother always tried to express what it's like to be a mother, you know, and having to take care and raise a child with autism and even as an adult, you know. Tim showed so much, I guess, interest in doing a charity for people with disabilities, and he called it Golden Blessings. Him and my mother advocated for this. We would talk, we would do meetings.
My name's Melissa Anderson, and my son, Cody Blythe, has autism.
How does Cody feel about being one of the leaders of Golden Blessings, our charity?
He's very excited. He's very excited for everyone to get to know him and for him to be able to help others that are like him. Both Cody and I are involved with the Golden Blessings charity that we're starting for autism right now. And I have to say it's something I'm very excited about. I'm also encouraged by some of these young kids that are leaders now. Although they have autism, they're extremely brilliant. They're eager to learn, they're eager to help, they're eager to mentor, and if we can get the word out and educate people about autism, they all struggle right now, and it's hard for them, especially even adults that are diagnosed in later years, to come to an understanding of what's going on with them and to be able to accept it and to know that there is someone out there that they can come to and talk to. And a place where they can come and get help is just ultimately the greatest thing.
And, well, Tim was the person that I was able to come and talk to and express my feelings towards. And just, even to the point where I was bullied in the Power Ranger fandom, it was like he was on my side to the point the Power Ranger fandom threatened him and his whole organization. And I guess that ended up working because we weren't able to do anything with what we had plans with. We were intimidated by the Power Ranger fandom and, you know, the people that were involved with it that can sit there and just apparently bully us into submission. I was bullied so bad that I was pushed into a feeling of suicide and depression. And, you know, I felt like everybody was trying to put me out on the pasture. Like, I really felt like I didn't belong in the Power Ranger fandom, a place that I felt like I could relate to the people the most. I was literally being pushed out. I wasn't allowed to be happy. I found comfort in Power Rangers because it was something that I loved, something that I really enjoyed, to the point that the Power Ranger fandom actually made me feel like when I wasn't welcome, I ended up selling everything in my collection. And I just don't feel like people understand what it's like to be completely rejected from something as simple as being a Power Ranger fan. You're supposed to feel comfort in that world, and it's the world that embraced you when you were a kid, when you didn't have a father. And that's probably what ruined me and mine and Tim's relationship, is that we had essentially built a relationship with something else in between us, and that was the Power Ranger fandom. I made the mistake in 2022 to bring them back. I was their handler and I was their agent for a little bit. I'm bringing up names and I really don't want you guys to be upset when I do, because this is just all about factual stuff and what I experienced in the process. I don't want this to be something that ends up becoming a hit piece for the Power Ranger the media and stuff to use against the people involved. I want to be able to express again my feelings, because I've gone 6 months without this friendship. It's been, I will get to that in a second, but again, in 2022, I remember when I had that phone call with Tim, it went from me feeling like I had nothing left in the world. I was talking to him about how I felt like I had nothing to look forward to. I was having a hard time with my roommate. My roommate was making me feel like it was just way too hard to live in that house. That was the start of everything. And I remember I was washing the dishes. And we were sitting there talking about how I feel like it would be amazing for me to be able to get back into what I was good at back in 2016. For those of you guys that do not know, I worked for a company that actually repped Power Ranger actors and put them out at conventions. I worked with Robert Axelrod, and I really enjoyed that. I worked with Kerrigan Mahan, who played Goldar. I did such a, like, I don't know, an expressive thing, being able to adapt to that type of thing. I felt like I was at home. I felt like I was being able to break away from being a fan and really try to start being professional and working with these people. And it felt like I was at home. Like I was really doing something that made me happy. And that fell apart real quick when I started finding out what it was like to work as an agent or a handler in the Power, just in conventions in general. And I've talked about this many times over, even people that have kind of explained how to do this job when they wanted to come into it, is that there's always sacrifices you have to make. And there's things that you have to lose in this business. Your sense of right and wrong, your morality. You have to be a shark swimming with other sharks. Otherwise, you're just going to be thrown out. This business, as a handler or an agent, or just in general, being involved in the business of doing conventions, everybody is ready to stab each other in the back. It's almost a mob mentality. The job might as well be freaking The Sopranos. Like, we were always sitting here trying to look over our shoulders, worrying about whether or not we were going to have clients stolen from us. And we called it poaching. you know, we had to put in our like a mental fortitude over our sanity just to be able to do a job. And I had to train myself mentally not to react to specific people when it came to this business. And then I ran into some people that just really pushed my buttons. And they ended up actually pushing me into a dark place by making up things about me. I remember they at one point, you know, made fake profiles and stuff of me claiming that I drowned cats and, you know, molested children. They were just making it seem like I was an easy target to throw under the bus because they found me as a threat. I was able to actually do something with my clients that I feel like as a person who runs a business, I am a quick thinker. I'm able to think on the fly. I can sit there and be like, hey, let's do this real quick when the day is young. Let's do it before everybody else does it. And that's what I did. I was able to accomplish so many different things, so many ideas with specific people. When it came to the triplets, I was like, hey, quick on my feet. Hey, let's see if we can do this. Can we do that? We were like able to go to the command center building. So this building is a prominent part of my childhood, right? And the thing is, I'm traveling with two Power Rangers over there. So somehow, in some way, we were able to pass the powers to Austin St. John with the original prop that was used in Power Rangers Zeo in 1996. I was flabbergasted that I was able to pull off some of this stuff. Man, this is the original screen-used golden power staff that they used in Power Rangers Zeo right here. This is nuts. Wow. The hands that touch this, huh? Wow.
The original staff we used back in 1996, Teddy. What do you think about that, Todd?
Yeah, baby. Gold Ranger Power, baby! Yeah. Come on!
Going to Vasquez Rocks, doing a photo shoot out there. We were just having the best ideas to help promote the triplets, even to the point when Power Morphicon happened in Vasquez Rocks. We did a short film to promote the event.
We have to get the Power Morphicon to reunite.
Kind of looking back on this footage too, it just shows a time where everything just seemed so perfect. It seemed like everything was going the way that I wanted it to go. Like I was paving the way to get these things, you know, accomplished, and they were big successes. They were doing something that I feel like I was just, you're like on the spot again, coming up with the, you know, power transferring and, you know, finding the original prop and figuring out what to do with all this stuff, making their designs, making their, you know, photos for their banners and stuff like that. I felt so complete. And but just behind the scenes, I kept, you know, pushing aside the fact that there was just kind of a power struggle between me and the triplets. I was so prideful of how quick they were able to make an impression in their first event, which was Fat Collectibles, which was, I believe, in like October or November of 2021. I was happy with how they were showing like this sense of excitement. They were really just ready to go out there and get what they deserved. I really felt like the triplets deserved the same admiration and love in the Power Ranger fandom as anybody else did, because they were a part of that fan base. They did have a role in the show. I always said there is no role too small or too big for the Power Rangers, and I always felt like the motto, once a Ranger, always a Ranger, applied. They were a actual Power Ranger. And even now I'm saying this, I already lost them, and they don't want to talk to me, apparently. They've never communicated with me. They just up and blocked me off my phone and everything. They just don't want to communicate with me. But I remember the first time I worked with them in, I believe it was the Comic Bug. Or it could have been the Comic Bug, or it was... I don't remember. It could have been We Can Be Heroes Comics, I think. Might have been the next one. I can't remember. But what ended up happening at that point, I remember before we prepped, they wanted me to... I don't know. I had another agent involved. Brandon Benfield. And Brandon and I have, for the past... I want to say almost decade, had a pretty good, you know, friendship.
Beautiful wife, Cody. Beautiful wife, Cody Blythe. Comma, Cody Blythe.
I never felt like Brandon was ever an opposer to anything. So I had many people under my belt when it came to contacting them. I asked Brandon to help me push them out because Brandon knows what he's doing. And I had also... MDMC author or MDMC talent agency, Martha, I had her involved, and I just felt like that was just like the dream team because they knew what they were doing. I was helping them. We were all kind of in the same, we were kind of new to the business at the same time almost. And I wanted to so bad make this work. So I got the best people that I knew involved. And almost immediately, there was a lot of pushback. So much pushback that I had to sit there with, like, I feel like I was a cliche with a piece of paper and a pencil in my mouth. I'm just sitting there listening to them. I was like, look, I'm taking mental notes. I'm trying to play devil's advocate here. I understand that you guys are upset, but listen, I know Brandon, and I'm going to tell you that he's going to do the best that he can do to get you guys out there. I kept pushing that and pushing that. The first instance it was an issue was the banner. Brandon, on top of him handling people, also did banner work. And he did make the first banner. The one thing that I remember from that banner when it came out was there was a few ooh and ahs coming from all three of them. And then a silent step back of disbelief when they didn't have the word original Gold Ranger put on that banner. And I remember the communication that I was having. I was sitting in their living room at the time. They were fighting over it. They were upset about it. To the point where I started crying because I started watching everything fall apart. In my viewpoint, like literally because of a word that didn't make it on the banner. It just said Trey of Triforia, Zeo Gold Ranger. It didn't have the word original. And apparently that was a very big level of disrespect to them that it carried over on everything that we did when it came to design work and promotion. And I tried so hard to let them know that that just did not matter to everybody. If we were to have put that on there, it's going to get the same result. The original is something that either people are going to embrace, people are going to understand, or people are just going to push off and sit there and say, no, fuck you guys, Austin St. John's the original Gold Ranger. Those things were like the start of essentially what was the sinking, okay? I remember all three of them fighting with each other over different things. And one of the things was over which photos were going to be used. One wanted the calendar photos that they had. I kept telling them this is a Power Ranger fandom. They're going to go after the Power Ranger stuff. I said, why don't we just make a photo that has a collage or something like that? They agreed with that. There were things that we ended up, everybody was fighting over. I also remember when they came to the signing that was in my hometown. They stayed with me at my house. Two of them were fist fighting with each other almost in my living room over something that was going on in their private life. To the point where Power Morphicon, the first day they were fighting over something as simple as t-shirts. They were just really eager to work. They wanted to be able to be put in that field of respect and admiration that everybody got in the Power Ranger fandom, no matter how big or small a Power Ranger was, whether it had been a voice actor or just somebody who had a bit part in the show. They felt like that they were just undermined and just were not loved or cared about. And it was something I had to keep telling them. Look how many people came to see you. I have it on camera. People gifted things to you. People actually care about you. And you guys are acting like that's not a thing? That wasn't a thing. I tried to plug as many holes as the ship was sinking. And Power Morphicon was the start of the ship breaking in half. It was the question of Power Morphicon staff with Scott Zellner. They had a big problem with Scott Zellner. They had a big problem with someone that they had never met before that was booking them for Ranger Stop. And eventually they canceled Ranger Stop over some reason. I'm pretty sure it was because their lack of promotion. That's what they said. Lack of promotion. Their image was way too small on the flyer. I just didn't understand. I remember when I called Brandon, because Brandon's the one that designed that. I was just like, look, we need to do something, because they're like literally throwing themselves into a huge fit right now about something as simple as how small they are on the poster. And things like that. Promotion was the biggest, like, onslaught. That was the start of everything that really just started going bad. We produced a video that was supposed to be really fun and inventive and cool. Power Morphicon wasn't sharing it, and they were getting upset about it. I told Brandon, we need to use that to promote them. We put a lot of effort and time into that. They need to promote that. These things that were happening weren't happening at the time that they wanted it to happen. Of course, I didn't agree with a lot of what Power Morphicon was doing. I was playing devil's advocate on both instances. I was like, Scott isn't the one that's doing the promotion. He has a team. Scott is going to sit there and observe. He is an observer. He's not one that organizes everything. He has a whole team for that. Brandon is only going to do what he's hired to do. He doesn't just work for you. He has like 50 some odd other clients that he does work for. And it felt like they wanted Brandon to be at his beck and call, or their beck and call. I ended up actually alleviating a lot of stuff by doing their banners. I did 8x10s. I did promotional work. I did video promotions. I did all this stuff that they wanted Brandon to do. I ended up doing to help alleviate a lot of the pressure. And I felt so prideful in seeing my work being shared around and enjoyed. But again, it felt like once Ranger Stop started rolling around, all hell broke loose. The cancellation announcement. And then, to the point, November was a really bad year for me. Or a bad month for me in the year 2022. Because I ended up getting a call from somebody, I won't name them, about one of the biggest emotional tragedies that's happened in this Power Ranger fandom was Jason David Frank's suicide. And it was, I think, shortly after Ranger Stop. And that, essentially, I remember calling the triplets and talking to them. They were eating with Sam Jones from freaking Flash Gordon. And I called Tim, and I was just like, I was telling him that JDF just killed himself. He's dead. I'm still in disbelief. I had gotten the news way before everybody else did, before all these news reports were talking about it. I was in the loop. I told them that, and they took it so hard for some reason. Which, of course, I would expect them to. But they never actually had anything positive to say about Jason David Frank at one point. They just as much as they hated Austin St. John or Brad Hawkins hated Jason David Frank, because they all had this like immense recognition from the fan base that they were like really jealous of. And I felt like I had to cap that, because at some point I was like, you guys have to be professional and you have to do this the right way. If you don't do it the way I'm going to tell you, you're going to lose it all. And for a while there, it was working out. And then I started seeing my relationship with Tim fizzle. There was a point where I was going to, after Morphicon, hang out with Wally Wingert, who played, Blue Psycho. He had this amazing Andy Kaufman collection that I went with Tim to go see at Wally's house. We ate dinner with him at the Chinese restaurant. And before Wally showed up, I sat down with Tim and I was like, look, I don't want to take away from the fact that this is probably one of the most exciting moments I'm fixing to have, because it has to revolve around one of my favorite subjects, and I'm sharing it with someone I care about. But I sat him down right next to one of those potter plants with this, you know, the brick siding around it. And I go, Tim, after Ranger Stop, I am not going to be working with you anymore. I did not want to ruin our relationship. And I think he took himself back a little bit, because I think he was a little shocked by that a little, because he felt like at one point I was only in it for, you know, the business, and I didn't care about him or his brothers, which I don't know what that is. I don't know why that, it, you know, made its way into his head, because it was never about the business and it was never about the money. It was about me trying to show them that people did care about them. I kept getting messages from a lot of people when it came to this goddamn fandom, okay? People were just like, we know you know the triplets. We want them to be involved. We want them to be at events and conventions and stuff like that. They thought they would really do really good. And I was like, okay, I agree, but they just don't want to come back. I had this, like, the better half of 5 some odd years. I was sitting here having people message me or email me asking me if the triplets were interested in work. The answer was always no. And then here we are, for some reason, in 2021 and 2022, their big comeback, a golden homecoming. It fizzled out so quickly. Because, of course, as everybody knows, the live stream started happening in like January, February. I don't remember exactly when. I just knew it was at the beginning of 2023. I really, really wanted this to work. And I kept asking Tim, I was like, Tim, are we going to be okay? Whatever happens, we're going to be okay. I don't want to lose you. He was a big part of me being able to recover from my mom's death. I actually felt like Tim was a great rock to lean on when it came to that. Because he understood how much, how that emotionally destroyed me, my sister, and how I have very little family or friends to talk to about these situations. Tim was the one that I feel like I really, really hate that this happened. To him, to everybody involved, I never wanted it to get this far. But they've got some kind of false sense of like this idea that I was always against them and that I never cared about them. There was words that Tim said to me that still haunt me to this day, that I put more effort into caring about my friends that I was living with, Jonathan and Nathan, when in reality was I was having a power struggle with the triplets and the business, and having to work as a graphic designer and agent, dealing with phone calls, putting everything on the side just to focus on them, while I was mentally struggling with my roommates being inconsiderate asswipes. And that friendship was dying, and it got to the point where I ended up getting in a fight with them. Something they probably do not know is I actually got into a physical altercation with Nathan and Jonathan, to the point it had me kicked out of my house. I was homeless for a week. and I had nobody to talk to. It's something that he really felt like, I feel that Tim was very happy to tell everybody about, was that we had a father-son relationship. But I got too fucking close to a guy that I let it happen again. I told myself I would never do that to myself again. That I would never let a man who claimed that they wanted to be a father figure to me. After all this happened, and after everything, after the phone call stopped, after the text stopped, after I tried to call them and it just went to voicemail, and my texts weren't sending in, and I found out that they blocked me. After all of that, I sold every single Gold Ranger thing that I had, because I knew that that friendship and that relationship was dead. And it destroyed me so much. I was really depressed. I got into so many bad fights with my roommates, I was ready to slit my wrists. It was just such a disastrous mental breakdown that I had with nobody there to be there for me. And the irony of this whole thing was those live streams that his brothers were posting about suicide and being there for people. Where were you? You left me in the dark. You gave up on me for some personal false sense of like self-righteous idea that you were better than everybody else. And I gave you an opportunity to build this business that you guys wanted. I did everything for you, and you just threw me away. Tim, you promised me you would never do this to me, and you did it. My mother would be ashamed of you for allowing to get that you got this far. You really, really hurt me. And it still lingers to this day. It is a feeling that I have to deal with, because not only did I have to lose you, I've had to lose 5 other friends. That was a domino effect from the mental hell that you put me through, where I felt like I was alone. I feel like I lost so much in the past 6 months that I should be proud of my fucking self for allowing myself to keep it in as long as I did. And I know that the way that you guys react, you threaten to sue people for a lot less. I'm sure you're ready to sit there and tell me you're going to sue me for publicly talking shit about you, but these are facts. These are facts that exist. And I've done nothing but advocate for you and care about you. And you turn your greatest ally and threw him away like trash. Even after those live streams, I was telling people they are really good people. They are good people. They have helped me. And they don't know how much that they helped me, that you helped me until now. This is a balance of positive and negative when it comes to you guys. And I'm talking to you as I would talk to you at any other instance. You let me down. And I guess I let you guys down too. By even remotely thinking it was a good idea to bring you into the Power Ranger fandom. I should have known better. And if I could go back and do it all over again, I would want to keep my relationship with Tim. But I can't. takes the best of me to sit here and try to hold back as much as I can emotionally. And I've done that with so many people. I did it with Nathan and Jonathan. I did it with Tim and his brothers. I did it with my mother. I did it with my sister. I've done it with everybody. I wish them the best, because obviously there's no fixing this, at least from my perspective. If they blocked me and they don't want to talk to me, that's a perspective that I can understand, is that, you know, they just want to run away from me. That's on them. But they left me in the dark. And I can never forgive them for that. Somebody who claimed that they would never do something like that to me. They made up a version of me that doesn't exist. They made assumptions that don't exist. I sold my sweat, my energy, everything that I did for them. Undone. I cared about them in a way that not even the Power Ranger fandom would care. They wanted that love and admiration that everybody else had. They had it even before this with me. Yeah, that's all I have to say.